A Vintage Christmas. Now, please welcome the director of music at the Church on the Way, Dr. Tom McDonald. Thank you.
wonderful time of the year. With those engines bailing and everyone telling you,
be a good cheer.
It's the most wonderful time.
Now, please also welcome the pastors of the Church on the Way, Dr. Jack Hayford and Dr. Scott Bauer.
Hello, good evening. Well, welcome to Music of Christmas. This is a priceless time for all of us because something of the real wonder of Christmas is our opportunity to spread. We've been having an incredible series of days since the opening of this month here at the church, and they've been wonderful because the one the prophets designated would be called wonderful has been in our midst, and we've been doing this grandly, haven't we, Scott?
Well, that's right. This is actually the third of four events that celebrate the Christmas season, and we want to welcome you to this, the fifth performance of the Music of Christmas. It's our most grand and glorious display of gifts and talents. And actually, of all of the events, this is the third of four, Pastor.
Sure. Well, we have the Advent candle that you see over to your right is a signal in Europe for the four Sundays of the Christmas season. We've adapted that tradition to our own use for years here at the church. And we light a candle at each one of the series of events that begins with our Christmas family summer show that takes place the first week. We have a series of dinners that the candles lit, second candles lit at that one. And at all our Music of Christmas events, we light the third candle, and we sing at all events an invitation to the Lord to say, we're here to gather and praise your name. Stand with us together, will you, Scott? Do the honors, light the candle, and let's all sing, shall we, Lord Jesus Christ,
Lord
Jesus Christ, to praise your name. Token of our gathering together, join hands, will you, bridge the aisles, and let's come as one congregation gathered to praise him together tonight. And Scott, lead us in prayer, would you?
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that as we gather this afternoon, that we would hear like the shepherds heard 2,000 years ago, the voice of the angels. Lord, that we would hear the voice of your love calling to us this night, that we would see a revelation of your loving kindness toward us. Like the light, the star over the manger, that the light of the love of God would flood our hearts today, that we would know your great and abiding care for us. And we gather this night in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Would everybody say two words, please? Blessed fullness.
Blessed fullness.
That's not to describe the feeling after your brunch. That's to describe the feeling of the season. I'd like to invite you to greet two or three people before you're seated and tell them, open to the blessed fullness of Christmas. Go ahead, do that. Open to the blessed fullness of Christmas. You may be seated. As you have seen, the theme of Christmas music 97 at the Church on the Way is a vintage Christmas. We chose that word vintage because of a double implication in the definition of the word. The first is that vintage describes those things that are classic, things that have found abiding, enduring value because of the contribution that they've made in a culture, in any given environment. It's a vintage or a classic thing. Then it's also the word that is used to describe the grape gathering, the harvest, and the wine that is made from that year's harvest. Vintage 1947, for example, you'll hear them describe, that was a very good year, as they describe wine. And as years go by, wine matures, and the seasons passed, and there is something lovelier, deeper, richer, more mellow about it. And this vintage Christmas, we're asking the Lord to pour forth of the wine of heaven into our midst, and to do something to season our own souls, not only with the joy of the season, but with a deeper maturity of our grasp of what the season is about. And as we begin this evening, Margie Shunk is going to come and sing what is a grown-up Christmas list. That's a part of that seasoning, deepening our view of the richness of Christmas's purpose in us.
Do you remember me? I sat upon your knee. I wrote to you with childhood fantasies. Well, I'm all grown up now, but still need help somehow. I'm not a child, but my heart still can dream. So here's my lifelong wish, my grown-up Christmas list. For myself, but for a world in need. No more lives torn apart, that wars would never start, and time would heal hearts. Everyone would have a friend, and right would always win, and
and
Something about the marvel of a full orchestra, full choir that brings such a breadth and depth to the music, we forget how simple it must have been in the early days of the Dickens-type singers in England when the English-type carol was first popularized. That was the concept in the composer's mind when the song Christmas Hymn was written, to be sung on the street by a handful of singers without accompaniment. We have a little bit more of a setting, but that simplicity is wrapped up in this same continuum. Lord, I want this improved and matured list that I ask of you in response. These are the matured gifts I bring back to you on this glad Christmas day. Listen to Christmas Hymn.
The year was 1962, and the occasion was a power lunch in New York City, at which time the venerable conductor, Robert Shaw, and a close friend met to talk about Christmas time and the American Symphony Orchestra. They had deduced that the public really wanted to hear classic Christmas songs, and yet for an orchestral conductor, there simply were not adequate arrangements. And so they set out on a mission, choosing 16 carols and setting them in groups of four with fabulous symphonic orchestral color. That work has come to be known as The Many Moods of Christmas, and now 35 years later, it will be performed in over 300 civic auditoriums this season alone. It's a demanding work, and I'm very proud of our sanctuary choir, and I know you'll enjoy Robert Shaw's vintage classic work, The Many Moods of Christmas.
That's magnificent. Oh, just beautiful. Well, Renaissance will be back with us at the for the second half of the program. And New Song, our other adult choir here at the Church on the Way, is going to be coming and ministering to us. And as they set themselves in position, would you just sing with me? Angels, we have heard on high. Would you declare it? Sing out. Lift your voice with me and sing.
Angels, we have heard on high. Sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song?
In the family of the Church on the Way is having two such outstanding choirs. Would you welcome New Song under the direction of Rose Stone?
So glad you come. my night. Behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. You gotta go, tell it on the mountain,
over the hills, and everywhere.
Go, tell it on the mountain,
that Jesus Christ is born.
Shepherds feared and trembled when
Bob Dawson is going to lead the orchestra in Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and I've admonished Bob on several occasions. Now, if you lead the band, we'd like to just recognize a little bit of the number as you lead us in Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Part 2 of A Vintage Christmas.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Boruch Shem Kevod, Malchuto Leolam Vahed. Lachen Yiten Adonai Hu Lachemot. Hine Ha'alma Hara Violedet Ben Vekarat Shemo Immanuel.
The sound of the cantor's song, the reading from the Torah, the declaration of the Hebrew blessing, all of it takes us back to the roots of the real Christmas, the original one. The roots are locked in something of the supernatural. Translation of those words are, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. The miraculous of God coming among us is what makes Christmas truly Christmas. It isn't the good feeling, the warm fuzzies, as delightful as they are. It's the miracle entry of God's power. And the miracle that was manifest in the virgin birth opened the door to a sequence of miracles, which even having raised that child in her home with her husband, Mary could not possibly have guessed the dimensions that the miracle would begin to manifest. It was new to her. She knew a miracle began. She couldn't possibly have imagined how far it would go. Mary, did you know what was taking place in all of its dimensions? Probably not. Probably not.
Just
Well, candles and Christmas are virtually synonymous. In fact, when they asked me and said, "Pastor, would you carry a candle out in introducing that next song?" I was afraid their next words would be, "Jack, be nimble, Jack." And I didn't suppose I was necessarily ready for that. Candles and Christmas lights everywhere. We string them on our houses. They spread around the world in many different expressions. Here in Southern California, we've grown familiar with what is common in the Mexican, other parts of the Latin world, and the luminarias. They're so beautiful, those sacks with sand and candles, and you see them lining the season, lining the housetops and the pathways, and all of it is for one reason. It is not just the accoutrements of celebration. Don't make any mistake of missing the point. The light has come. The light has come, and the darkness can never be the same. And the gift of the light to us in Christ is given for a reason: to soften our hearts. The warmth of heaven come to earth. It is not merely symbolic. It is the entrance of a reality that light has come to our understanding, come to warm our hearts, come to make possible our finding the path we were always meant to walk. John Rutter has written one of the most poignant Christmas melodies and lyrics I think I've heard. I'm sure you'll enjoy them. Listen closely to Candlelight Carol.
Thank you.
dancers are something. You know, I can do that. The lights of Christmas, of course, there's the glory that shines with the visitation of the angels. There's the radiance that we think of in the warmth of the manger setting, where doubtless a fire attempted to warm the chilled atmosphere. But the most famous light of Christmas is the star. And the significance of the star is far more than just light. The light of Christmas, by every expression, is intended to bring warmth. Warmth that'll soften our souls. Our souls do become hardened. It's not even necessarily a response that is rebellious or intentionally malevolent in any regard. Hearts become hard through the pressure of circumstance. The intensity of life can breed a hard heart. Hearts can become hard for the want of refreshing, just as ground does. But the softness that comes through the warmth of the light not only is something that touches our emotions, but the kings and their coming, following the star, were following something that for them was an intellectual and political pursuit, not for cheap political reasons, but for diplomatic and gracious ones. They came to honor a new king, and they came as a result of their studies and their sense that something dramatic was happening in the world, which indeed it was. They're the epitome of the reflection of good sense, high economics, intelligent brilliance. And these things brought them to the feet of the Savior, where they're overwhelmed. They fell before him, the scripture says, and in that moment of worship, they had found the light. We have three kings that are coming to sing for you. They're ours. Lewis and Cy and Rick are the name of our three kings, and you can see the light in their eyes, and you're going to resonate to it. Let the light keep warming your heart. I have seen the light. The Bible says when the shepherds came back, that they came telling everyone of what they'd seen. When the wise men left, that they went in another fashion, another way than they'd come. An encounter with the light of the love of God and the person of His Son is transforming. And it calls us to hear again the message of the angels as the glory shone round, as the light of heaven shone in on that first Christmas, that vintage Christmas beyond all, said to you today a Savior. Say those words with me, would you? To you today a Savior. Say to someone, that goes for you and me. Go ahead, say it. Say it to them, that goes for you and me. It does. The Savior is for us all. And we're called to open to Him. And the Christmas Day focus finally calls us to this day, any day that we hear of its meaning. It can be July the 18th. It can be September the 1st. It can be April the 8th. But the day that we recognize and open to the love of God, we've acknowledged this day that I understand, that I hear, I need to respond this day.
Soon it will end.
this day, let us share the love of God with you. Let us share the promise, the hope, the desire of the Lord that we open to Him, that we know Him, receive Him. When we walk through the Christmas season, we come to terms with the fact that God is reaching our way. And He's wanting to get our attention to the day beyond this one, the day beyond Christmas Day. Christmas was for one reason. God so loved the world, He gave His Son. And His giving of His Son was that we might be saved. Saved requires a Savior. A Savior required someone to absorb in themselves the penalty for our sin. It's a very real commentary on our culture's desire to hyper-simplify everything to say, well, can't we just have love and good feelings and all those kind of things and not bother with this Jesus and the cross and things like that? I mean, why do we have to get that into the mix? And the fact of the matter is, loved ones, that wherever there is the absence of a message of redemption, that it doesn't work. No matter how much of the warm fuzzies that you try and introduce, no matter how much convention would assign the best of hopes to human capacities, they finally fail because we're sinners that need a Savior. And that's why the cross. And we come to Calvary, and Stephen and Linda Tavani are coming to sing for us the song of the day beyond days, the day when Christ took it all for us, and having died, rose again, and now He bequeaths to us the gift of forgiveness of sins, the promise of eternal life, and the power of God in our lives day by day. Which is why this song says, Calvary came through once again. Whatever it is that we face, that we're struggling with, whether it's our pride that needs to humble before God on His terms, or whether it's a struggling point of need in our lives, the cross is adequate. Calvary came through. The day above days, the day for which Christmas was, now has been realized, and it's for us all. Stephen and Linda.
Well, I found the victory, conquering hell.
Bible says, prevent that I would ever glory in anything else than the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not the cross for a symbol, because as a symbol it has been misused, abused, and it represents things that any one of us would be ashamed of by what humanity have often done with the cross. But what Jesus did on the cross is something that speaks to every one of us. Open. Open to the love of God. You're the same as I am. You're a sinner that needs a Savior. All of us are. And God's gift to us is the forgiveness of sins, that it is the utmost presumption to suppose we don't need to come to terms with. To come to Him, say, Lord, I want to thank You. I want to thank You for the gift. Thank You, God, for sending Jesus. Thank You, Jesus, that You came. Holy Spirit, move in my heart. Jesus said, look, I'm standing at the door. I'm knocking. If you'll open the door, I'll come in. He puts the initiative on our side. He's a gentleman. He's provided a gift. He forces no one to receive it. He's provided God's grace. He requires no one to open to it. But He says, if you will, I'll give you the gift. And if you'll ask me in, I'll come in. And so we've learned to sing a little song, and I'd like to invite you to sing it with us. Everyone, open your heart and sing, Into My Heart. Would you sing?
Into my heart. Into my heart. Come in.
Many of us in this room have already opened our heart to the love of God, and if you never have, you know you haven't. I don't mean by that you're a hateful person, that you despise things of God, but you've never come to a point of personal welcome of God's gift. And like any gift, until it's received, it serves you no personal value. And God has spent great price to say, here's your Christmas gift, life for you in the Son. And I'd like to invite you to pray. And those of us that have opened to the Lord, I'm going to ask you to pray that others in the room who would want to pray this prayer might have our encouragement and our participation for our own way, in which we'd say, Lord, though I've asked You in my life, I want to freshly say, Jesus, this Christmas time, shine Your life through me in a new dimension. Let's all pray together, may we? Let me lead you phrase by phrase. Let's bow our heads. Would you pray? Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, I bow in prayer. I make this request. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. I need You. I need You as my Savior. And I choose to believe You are the gift of God to me. You who died and rose from the dead. I say, come into my life. Show me how to walk in the Father's way. I ask, O Lord, You'd fill me with Your Spirit. Let the blessed fullness of Christmas fill me with forgiveness, fill me with Your joy, and fill me with Your purpose as I turn from my way to Yours through Christ the Lord. Amen. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus.
And now we come to the climax of the music of Christmas. Let's stand together as this song is heralded for centuries, the vintage classic, the Hallelujah Chorus, as we glorify the Lord in this conclusion.